I have to thank you again for giving me an opportunity to come and talk to you.
Thank you.
It is, it's very significant on the day, 20th of September.
Yes.
This is Ulster Day. And how the people of Ulster appreciate it. I'm not going to give you a talk on Ulster Day, because I think too many people have covered it or you've heard of it all before. What I want to talk to you about is something completely different, something that people very rarely know anything about. In fact, it's one of those unknown events that people seem to have misled in our history because of the lack of, not the lack of knowledge about it, but the lack of the written word about it. And that's about Ulster's Forgotten War in 1914-18, the Eastern Front. Everybody talks about the Western Front and the Somme and everything that happened during that period. But people seem to forget that during 1914-18, UVF men from the Shankill Road and 36 Ulster men fought at the Eastern Front alongside Russians and Romanians and Czechs. Men from the UVF that could have and were involved in the events that's world renowned, but could have and might have changed the course of history because of their actions. Men from the Shankill Road who fought alongside the Russians in the Russian War 15-17, and they were involved in the Russian Revolution. Men who were involved and associated with the assassination of the mad monk Rasputin in December 1916. The Bolshevik Russian Revolution that changed the face of world politics and the dominion force that Russia has now become as a world power within the context of the world today. And the rescue of the Russian Tsar and the royal family. All those things that happened during this period was when the UVF and the 36 men from the side of the 36th were involved in the Eastern Front. And as you can see it, it was actually from Belfast to a place called Baku, which is in Azerbaijan today. So from Belfast all the way around near half the world, right to the other side of Europe, to a wee place called Baku and back again. That's how far they travelled. So what we're going to look at is their role in some of those events. And what started it off was the beginning of World War I. You can see it there that Russia and Germany and Britain and all the allies and the internet of that period all came together to fight each other over the domineering of Europe. But in that period is also, we had our own in-house turmoil. We had the Home Rule crisis, and we were going through a severe period of unknown of what was going to happen to the Ulster or Unionist people of Ulster. It became an episode in our history that today has worked out to us living in a place called Northern Ireland today. But the main context of this is a guy called Oliver Stillingfleet Locker Lampson. Anybody's ever heard of him?
No.
Never?
I'm sure.
You've never heard of Locker Lampson?
No, they didn't start about it. Shame on me.
Locker Lampson was as much a UVF man as you could have got during this period. He was also the Unionist Parliamentary MP for Ramsay in 1910. So he was an ardent supporter of Edward Carson and the UVF. He was actually Carson's cousin, twice or three times related. In fact, Locker Lampson was the man who, sitting in the officers' club in London, when Sir James Craig was giving him an earful about how the state of Ulster is, that he pulled out his chequebook and wrote a cheque for £1,000 to arm and to uniform the UVF. And he told Craig, don't worry about the other £9,000, I'll have it to you within a week. So at that time, Locker Lampson and £10,000, which is quite a sum of money, it is, was there in support of what was happening in Ulster at the time, along with Carson. But an ardent Unionist and an ardent UVF come Carson's supporter. Oliver Stillingfleet Locker Lampson That name gives me a name of another person, that, what do you call that other person? Somebody else usually uses a name, something similar to that.
Huntington
Smythe. It is. But he was elected in 1910 as a unionist. He stood on the unionist ticket. So he did, as part of the unionist party. And he was elected as an MP in Ramsey in 1910.
Is that Ramsey, the Isle of Man?
No. It is. Well, what Locker was also doing prior to the outbreak of World War One, it formed an organisation called the Ulster Field Force. And his job was to recruit and to get as many motor cars or lorries as possible to support the UVF or the 36th Ulster Division on the fields of the Somme for ambulances or for other mechanised use. And that's what his role. He put an advert in the Times in London asking for people to donate their vehicles in whatever form or whatever shape they wore to be used as a UVF ambulance or a supply vehicle for the UVF or the 36th Ulster Division. That's an example of one there for the Ballymena district that was brought together for the war. But one of the other things about the war at this period was the ability for pilots, who were a scarce commodity at the time, for pilots to be rescued if they ever got shot down into no man's land. And also if the opportunity arose to reclaim the plane, because the plane was an expensive commodity as well. But the pilots was more important, not only because of their life, but because of what they could do. They were a pilot, which in those days was a highly sought after skill that was few and far between. So the British government realised this, that this bunch of men, this exceptional bunch of men who flew planes, was a scarce commodity and that needed to do something when people like the pilot was landed in no man's land. So what they did was they set up a scheme that would use old lorries to go out into no man's land or to places where the plane came down and to retrieve the pilot and if necessary the plane also. So you can see how important the mechanised or motor vehicle became during this period. The person that did it was Commander Charles Sampson. He set up what was known as the Royal Naval Air Service. Now it had nothing to do with the army, it was part of the Royal Navy. And Commander Sampson realised that it was an important issue because a lot of the pilots were attached to ships and to the Navy at the time. And they needed to retrieve the planes. So Sampson started up the Royal Naval Air Service, which is the forerunner to the tanks and the armoured car divisions that we have today. But one of the things that he needed was motorised vehicles. So what they did was, they took old Rolls Royces and old Lancasters, that's a typical one there, and they rejigged them into armoured vehicles to be used to go out and retrieve the pilots and the planes from the man's land. They took old Model T Fords, there's one there, and they put a machine gun on it. And they were sending that out to no man's land as well, along with the mechanised vehicle, to try and retrieve the pilot without coming under any harm or injury. To give you an example of one, that's an old Lancaster that was taken to the border maker's shop and told to put on pieces of armour that could safeguard the tires and safeguard the men. Because when they went out into no man's land in the old Royces or the old Lancasters and came under machine gun fire, the sheet metal of the Rolls Royce didn't hold up too well to machine gun bullets coming through it. So they had to create some sort of defensive mechanism, and that's what they did. They safeguarded the tires and safeguarded the men, and that was used to retrieve pilots. That's a typical example as it started to develop into what is known as the armoured car. They started to add different stages to it to make it more usable and more practical in its work. Till we got to that stage there in 1915, where it actually did become an armoured vehicle for the Royal Naval Air Service. And that's actually one there with the machine gun. So you can see how the development of this here started to happen. That's the end result. In 1914, at the Royal Naval Air Service, because of the high motorized, mechanized vehicles that they were starting to develop, now he changed his name to the Royal Naval Armored Car Division. So it became the actual forerunner that we have today of the armored cars. And that's a typical example of one. And if you look at it, it gives you the shape of a ship, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. The old shape of a ship still there. You can see the sailors with the sailors' hats. Man, that's what you do. You can see the involvement that the Royal Navy still had, even though there were what they would call land crafts, or mechanized motorized vehicle, solely for land. But because of the way the war developed and the way the war was moving into what they call trench warfare, the motorized vehicle became more of a hazard of going out into no man's land that was pitted with trenches and shell holes. In a lot of stages, if they did try to go out, they couldn't get back again. And on enough occasions, they were losing the men and losing the vehicle. So trench warfare became an obstacle for the use of the motorized vehicle. Also, the muck in and around Flanders also became a massive problem for them. So I got to a stage where in 1915, in the summer of 15, that the army who were getting and shouting so much about the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division infringing on their rights into the battlefronts about who managed and who was responsible, that the British government decided they would deploy the Royal Naval and would hand them over to the army for full control. So the army at the end of the day got their way. They were taken off the fields of the Somme and off the Western Front and deployed to places like Egypt, where they become more of a use and more practical in their usage. But the guy we're going to look at is Commander Oliver Stillingfleet Locker Lampson. I'm actually surprised that nobody's ever heard of him. As the war progressed in December 1914, Locker had what they call political connections. He was a well-known family and he was a well-known person in his own right. One of his closest friends was Winston Churchill, whereby Edward Carson being a relative and being a personal friend. His other friends was the likes of Churchill and also the Tsar of Russia. So in December 1914, Locker approached Churchill about getting back into the army or back into the navy, given a role within the war effort. And he was brought into the Royal Naval Air Service in December 1914 as Lieutenant Commander, with the understanding that he would raise his own division, armored car division. He would pay for it, finance it, support it, and take it to the Western Front to be used as part of the war effort. And Locker agreed to all this. He would finance it, he would buy the cars, he would have them refitted, he would recruit all the men, and he would be part of the war effort on the Western Front. And that's what his understanding and his obligations were. But the problem with Locker is when he was getting into the war, just coming into the summer of 1915, the British government decided that the armoured car division was impractical to be used on the Western Front. It needed other things for it. And some of the other places that they were looking at deploying it was places like Russia. Because Russia was coming under massive, massive pressure from the Germans. The Germans were driving the Russians back. And the Russian army, after just coming out of being defeated by Japan a number of years previously, was not in a state of a military force that could combat the Germans. The British government were worried if the Eastern Front was taken completely, the Germans then could direct all their energies back to the Western Front, which would make it a lot harder to secure the Western Front and to win the war in that position. So Locker, in his negotiations with Churchill and his friendship with the Tsar, offered the services of the 15th Squadron to be sent to Russia as part of the war effort and support of the Russian and the Eastern Front. So what did Locker do then? Well, Locker, because of his involvement with the UVF, went back to his roots, to the men and to the area where he knew best, where you get the men to support his means of taking an armoured car division to the Russian front. Because of his work with the Ulster Free Force and the procurement of motorised vehicles, and of his work with the UVF during the Home Rule crisis, he knew the type of person and the type of man that he was looking for. And he found that within the UVF here. He recognised that the UVF already had a mechanised, motorised, armoured vehicle. And this is one here of the UVF in 1914. He knew the UVF had a ready supply of men who were motor mechanics, chauffeurs and drivers of motorised vehicles, which in those days was a rare commodity as well, because a lot of people didn't know how to drive a car, didn't know how to repair a car, didn't know the fundamentals makeup of a car. So he was looking for a very, very typical person who could fill the role that he was looking for as part of his armoured car division. This is Locker's Rolls Royce that he took and transferred into an armoured vehicle. He recruited 111 men from Ulster to fight with the 15th Squadron in Russia. And of that 111 men, 10 of them were from the Shankill Road alone. Now, why did men from the UVF be recruited into Locker Lampson's Royal Naval Armoured Car Division? Now, one of the things that he enticed them with, more than anything, was the rank that he gave them. Every person that enrolled and joined up with Locker was given the rank of petty officer, simply because of the skills that they had and the knowledge they had with motor vehicles, and because they were coming into the war as petty officers, was a bit more, as I say, financial, better off than going in as an ordinary private or driver into the army. So he did. So of the 111 men, and there was just over 500 in a squadron, the 15th squadron, 111 there, 5 of them were Ulster men. In fact, he was so sincere about his connections with Ulster that 3 of the armoured cars that he had developed, he called Ulster, Mountjoy and Londonderry. And that's a picture of them there, outside Sawyer's shop. It is. And those 3 cars, Ulster, Mountjoy and Londonderry, were heavily involved in the battles at the Russian front and heavily involved in the Russian Revolution and places like that. So they went from all the way from the Shankill Road in Belfast, all the way up to a place called Archangel, and all the way down to a place in Azerbaijan called Baku. So they were well travelled through the war. So as you can see from that map there, Russia and the Eastern Front came under massive pressure from the German war effort, starting to force the way back. And it was needed that Locker would go in support with his 500 men to aid the Tsar in the Russian war effort in maintaining or holding the Germans at a status quo to allow the Western Front to develop. The place that they travelled to was a place called Archangel, Murmansk, and then into a place called Archangel. And that's where they were stationed, just at the north the part of Russia. It was actually part of their makeup that every Christmas, or the Christmas times that they were there, and some of the cases that they were there, they were actually singing God Save the King. And it became known as the most northernest part of the world that God Save the King was ever sung at. So this, but that's where they landed. They formed up with some of the Cossacks and some of the Russian soldiers, and that's a platoon of the Russian soldiers with the Union Jack. Now you have to understand what the Russian army was like at this period. They were disentangled, they were made up of a whole lot of different other country soldiers, Ukraine, Romania, the Cossacks, all amalgamated under the Russian state, but all with different culture and different cultural backgrounds. So when Locker went into this environment, you could see the hardship and the task that he was given. So it was a no-win situation for him, but it was one of the things that he was tasked to do. This is a picture of the Tsar and the Cossacks, who fought with Locker. So you can see who he came across. He came across a range of fighting soldiers, who some didn't have the stomach to fight, and some who would give their lives for Russia. And in different battles, he came across where when the generals of the Russian army were leading the soldiers in, and Locker was there at the head of the charge. When he looked back, the soldiers were going back a ways, and the generals were all standing by themselves, with the Russian soldiers running the other way. And that was some of the cases that Locker had to experience fighting with the Russian army. It is one of the places that he went to after leaving Archangel was the Koskin front line there, just on the other side of Turkey, where he engaged the Turks just outside the Caucasian mountains there. Some of the places that Locker went, along with some of the UVF men from the Shankill, were some of the most hospitable places that the world could offer. So it is. They were fighting in mountain ranges, they were fighting with people who couldn't speak English, they were fighting in environments where they really weren't welcomed. And there were such a small band of men within this great big environment. It was a massive task for them. But they got well down to it. And some of the cases that you read about during this period of their heroism and the way the men held themselves coming under massive fire, with their cars being ripped to shreds by machine guns and having to lie underneath them till darkness came to make their escapes, was totally unbelievable. The other places they went to from the Caucasian Mountains was up to Romania, up to the front there. So that, and when we look at these territories, we look on a map in such a small area. But in most cases, it was hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles through the most terrible terrain you could ever think of to travel to these places, not knowing what's going to happen to you or not knowing what you're going to face when you get there. So that was one of the other battles I'm involved in. Another one was there at Galicia, let's say Tarnopol. So that's where they engaged with the Austrian Germans on that border. So one minute they're fighting the Romanians, one minute they're fighting the Turks, and then the next minute they're fighting Austrian Germans. All different calibers of men and all different calibers of battles. Some would be armed soldiers, and some would be just run-of-the-mill peasants that he came across. But all the hardships that had to endure. They went from the Arctic, which was up into the snows, so that down into the plains of Armenia, where it was all desert, and then down onto the area around the Danube, where the muck and the silt was about 3 foot, 4 foot high. So you can see some of the things they had to endure, as it just wasn't taking a car down the road, like we know today, and going to the front. This was cross terrain that was very, very inhospitable and very, very hard to endure. But that's the conditions they lived under. That's the conditions they had to endure. Far cry from the fields of the Somme, yes, but more than ever, far cry from the streets and the roads of Belfast and Ulster at that period. It was into the unknown where it took them, into places that they would only ever knew of on a map, but this time they were actually experiencing the reality of it. What brought it to a shudder and halt was in March 1917, the beginnings of what we know now as the Russian Revolution. And it started over women at a factory coming out because there was no bread, there was no milk, there was no butter, there was no basic food supplies. The people were starving. So it was most of the food was being directed towards the soldiers at the front. So the people in the factories and the workers were denied their food and in most cases starving to death. And they decided they had enough. And in March 1917 they came out in strike. So they did, were supported by the workers from the coal fields, and the Irish fence and the soldiers. And it took its momentum from that till there was an overthrow in March 1917 of the Tsar, who, because of the inabilities of his generals, had to go to the front to lead the Russian army himself personally. So he was left vulnerable along with his family, and that gave it the momentum that the Russian Revolution was able to take control of the big cities and off the army, and finally take control of Russia completely. And that happened during the beginning of March, right through to October 1917. So in July 1917, Locker, because he was caught up in the revolution, needed to get his men back to safety. He was in a hostile territory, not only were the Germans at his back, but now with the Russian Revolution at his front, caught in between the devil and the deep blue sea. And he had to make arrangements to get his men back to England and back to safety. And that's exactly what he had to do. In September 1917, he engaged with these three unruly guys, Mr. Stalin, Mr. Lenin, and Mr. Trotsky, to give safe passage to his armoured car division, to the island to get back to Archangel, where they were picked up and taken back to safety in England. And it was Mr. Trotsky there, the guy with the glasses on the far right, who made all the arrangements for the safe passage of Locker Lampson and the men from Ulster and his armoured car division to return after nearly 2 years at the Russian front to back to safety in England. During that period when they were out there, the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division suffered a number of casualties. In the period Locker was there, they had 4 deaths and 11 injured. And in the period when they went back to Baku till 1918, there were 17 actually killed and just over 40 were seriously injured. One of the first men to die in the Royal Armoured Car Division was a guy called Joseph Dunley from Alexander Park Avenue, PO. He came from Alexander Park Avenue, but he befell death in a very strange way. He drowned. He was a seaman, as a Navy person. They were bathing in the river one day, cleaning themselves, and he couldn't swim, or he wasn't a great swimmer, and he actually drowned. And he was the first casualty of the Royal Navy Armoured Car Division. Second one was T.C. Skivington Graham from Upper Canning Street, and he was taken by the Turks as a prisoner of war, and he died from malnutrition, from starvation, as a prisoner of war in Turkey. So you can see some of the hardships some of these men had to go through. But going back to the Shankill, it's this guy here, Petty Officer John McFarlane, DSM, came from number 90, Northumberland Street. His family also lived in Longford Street as well, but he's registered in Longford Street and also in number 90, Northumberland Street. But the irony of John McFarlane's death was the date of his death. 1st of July, 1917. Of all the hundreds of men from the Shankill that died on the 1st of July, 1916, John McFarlane, also from the Shankill on Northumberland Street, followed him a year later on the 1st of July. That is, of all the 4 deaths, it was ironic that a Shankill roadman had to die on the 1st of July, 1917. He's buried in Poznan Cemetery in Poland, that is, in a far off place, along with Skivington Graham and Joe Dunley as well. So you can see from that, and there's a lot of interesting stories that creep up through the escapades of Locker Lampson and the UVF men from the Shankill and from Ulster that went with them. One of the stories was the Scottish Women's Hospital. These were nurses that were recruited to go off to the different theatres of war where British soldiers were fighting, and to offer aid to these people who might suffer injuries during the war conflict. But Robert McDowell from Bangor and Nurse Maguire from Bangor happened to be in a place called Tulsia in Romania when Robert McDowell and Locker Lampson and the Armoured Car Division rode into it one day. And seeing the nurses there speaking English, they got engaged to conversation with some of the nurses. And lo and behold, Robert McDowell, all the way from Bangor in Northern Ireland, engaged with this nurse, Maguire, who was also all the way from Bangor in Northern Ireland. But funny that their meeting took place at a place called Tulsia in Romania, in a far off field during World War I. So it's funny how people from Little Northern Ireland travel across the world, but yet managed to bump into each other. So they do. And that is an interesting story from that. So there's a nurse Tulsia there, so you can see on the Caspian Sea, that little pokey wee place happened to be the meeting place of two little people all the way from Bangor. But in April the 1st, 1917, Russia surrenders and offers the peace treaty to the Germans, which meant the war in Europe took on a different phase. The Eastern Front no longer existed no more, and the Germans were able to pull their soldiers from the Eastern Front and redirect them back to the Western Front, which meant the change of power and the change of the ability to combat the Germans in World War I took on a different mantle. That is, the Russian Civil War kicked in 1918 to 1920, and you can see that the whole of Russia became in turmoil as well during this period, but without the Germans' involvement. Mm-hmm. So after the Royal Navy Armoured Car Division managed to get his way back to England, Locker Lampson never went back. He did go back with him, but that was the end of the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division. Locker then was seconded to work for the British government because of the happenings of the Russian Civil War in Russia. He became part of the Russian Information Division that the British government set up to keep tabs on what was happening within and outside of Russia. And that's some of the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division on his way back into England. The funny thing about it is that it's such an important force, such an important role within the war, they decided that the experience that these men gained at the Russian front, the experience of the Armoured Car Division, wasn't going to be put to a loss. They were going to redirect it to other theatres of the war, and they were taken back into a force called Dunster Force. Anybody's ever heard of it? Dunster Force was the machine gun corps who was transformed into a group called the Dunster Force, and it was organised by General Dunsterville, that's him there, who took Dunster Force to an important place that was so critical to the war effort, was so critical to what was happening on the Western Front. It was to a place called Baku, and that's it down there, Baku. So there's Archangel up there, and the Locker and them has fought all the way around this, but the 77 men from the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division under Locker Lampson, most of the Ulster men, all ended up back in Baku after arriving back in England. They were sent back to Baku. Now, one of the reasons why they were sent back to Baku was because Baku and Azerbaijan at that time was the main oil supply. It was the oil fields. And what the British government and its allies didn't want was those oil fields falling into the hands of the Germans. Because if the Germans got their hands on the oil, then they're able to supply their motorised vehicles, supply all their tanks and all their divisions, and it would put a greater mechanism back into force into the Western Front. So that's why the oil fields of Baku became such an important element within World War I. After the exploits of the men during this period in Russia, the Russian government bestowed upon them the St. Stelios and the Medal of St. George for their bravery and the work. Now, there's numerous accounts of the men's bravery coming under fire the small detachment of men fighting with Locker against massive armies and holding these armies back at a critical time in the period of the war. So it was important that they were recognised, and the Russian government did recognise them for their war effort, because it stopped the advance of Germany right into the heartlands of Russia. One of the other things that did when they were redeployed was Locker Lampson himself personally wrote to every man under his command, and he personally gave him a 15 shilling savings certificate for each man. So that's how much he thought of the men that fought with him. Because he recognised their bravery and their commitment to him and to the war effort. But actually taking the time to write to every individual man under his command was something different. So we've looked at the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division, the involvement with the Ulster men in Russia and how they were involved in things. Locker himself, people look at Locker and Lampson and they would cast him as one of these adventurous film star types. No, one of these ones that always had to be the film star in the big film. So it is. Was Locker Lampson like that? No. He was a dedicated soldier. He was a dedicated Englishman. He was a dedicated member of the British Empire. But more than anything, he was probably as brave could be. So some of the escapades that he got involved in, along with him, was the killing of Rasputin in December 1916. The things that changed the course of history, not only in Russia, but across the world. And how did Locker get involved with the murder of Rasputin? It was through this guy here, Morris Cummings. Anybody ever hear of him? No. Anybody's ever watched the James Bond movies? What do you call the head of British intelligence?
M.
Well, in this period, he was called C. Because Morris Cummings was the head of British intelligence during World War I. And I'll tell you what the type of person he was. Morris Cummings, one day, was travelling through France in his open car, his open tour, along with his son, driving along the road. When he was involved in a car crash, the car overturned and smashed up, and the son was thrown out, and Cummings was caught underneath the car and couldn't get out. There was nobody about, it was only him and his son. The son was down, and Cummings couldn't get away. He was pinned by the car. So what did he do? He took out his penknife and cut off his leg, and managed to crawl over to his son, who was dead. So he did. But that was the type and caliber of the person that he would do that. There it is. But he became the head of British intelligence. And he wanted Rasputin dead. He wanted him dead for one reason, and one reason only. The Tsar was at the head of the Russian army, leading the Russians into battle against the Germans on the Eastern Front. While Rasputin was back in Petrograd, along with the Empress, the Tsar's wife, and he was having a massive influence on her to such an extent that the Allies were concerned that he was getting her to change her mind and getting her to change the Tsar's mind to make a peace treaty with the Germans, which meant the Russian front and the Eastern Front would come into an area where the Germans wouldn't need to worry about. And Cummings was concerned that Rasputin had this influence that would allow the Empress to influence the Tsar to call for a peace treaty. Then it was a major problem for the Allies. So what he did was order the assassination of Rasputin. And one of the persons that he went to was Locker Lampson. And Locker was asked, along with a number of others, to participate in the assassination of Rasputin. Now, the actual assassination was done by a member of the royal family. So it was who actually shot Rasputin himself. But Locker, in his memoirs and in his stories, never went into great detail what his involvement was. All he says was that he was asked to participate in it, and that was more or less the end of it. So you can take your own thinking from it, lie or high, or what's really the play of it. But it was interesting to see Grayson Tomlinson and Morris Cummings. One of the other things that he was involved in, and he talks in his diaries about, was the rescue of Princess Tamanov in a hotel in Petrograd. When the Russian Revolution was at its height, some of the revolutionaries tried to come in to capture the princess, and Locker, along with one of his officers, managed to safeguard her and managed to arrange her escape out of the hotel without being injured. He talks about coming under heavy machine gun fire and kicking the hotel door down and being riddled with bullets and so forth and so forth. So his heroics in this period is all laid out, and that's the letter he wrote describing the rescue of the Princess Tamanov. One of his other escapades was his involvement with the rescue of the Tsar and the Tsar's family after the Russian Revolution took hold and the Tsar was deposed. He was being held in his palace, and Locker was approached to make arrangements to rescue the royal family and to get them out of Russia. Now, Locker says that he managed to bribe the guards with drink and with money and with cigarettes. And on the night in question, when they went to rescue the Tsar wouldn't leave, because if the whole family didn't go, the Tsar wasn't going. He wanted the whole family to go. But at that time, Locker could only organise a false beard and the clothes of one of the guards, and only one person could be rescued. So the Tsar said, no, I'm staying. So history tells us then what happened. They were all assassinated and none of them survived. But Locker did his best to rescue the whole royal family. So that was Locker's involvement with that. Locker's involvement with Adolf Hitler is another interesting one. During World War I, when Hitler was a corporal and got injured on the Western Front, he was recuperating in a hospital after the war, when Locker, along with a number of other British officers, came across Mr. Hitler. And Hitler was watching the British officers play the game of cricket one day and got into a conversation with him that he would like to organise some German soldiers to form a team and to play a game of cricket against the British officers. And after the game of cricket, when they were thrashed, he was supposed to come up to the officers in Lockhart and say, what a disgusting game, the terror game. If that had been a Russian game, they wouldn't wear pads or protective clothing. They would just get out there and smash a ball. So that was Lockhart's version of his encounter with Adolf Hitler in World War I. But Locker did associate, and he was a very respected and very impressionable person, as is Locker with Prince Philip. There's only Prince Philip today, married to the Queen. So that's Locker there with Prince Philip. That's Locker there with Ernest Shackleton, the great explorer. So you can see the type of social circle that Locker was able to move in. And that's Locker there with Albert Einstein, who managed to arrange for the escape of Albert Einstein from Belgium under the noses of the Nazis in World War II, so that Einstein didn't fall into the hands of the Nazis during this period. So you can see how Locker in his social circle and the fraternity that he ran about in. But probably one of the most interesting ones is this guy here, Sir Walter Dorning Smiles. Nobody's ever heard of him. Sir Walter was one of Locker's officers. In fact, after they came back from Russia, Sir Walter was second in command of Dunster Force because of his experience with the Armoured Car Division. He was also the Unionist MP for Down during the 50s. And during the Great Storm in 1953, just off the coast of Larne, in the Princess Victoria, when it sank, Sir Walter was and his wife was on board when he lost his life. There it is. So our association, or the association with Ulster and all these famous people through Locker Lampson, But through Welch or Welter here, probably one of the more interesting associations is with this guy, Bart Willis. Now, I know you've all heard of him, haven't you?
Yes.
The adventurer. You've never heard of Bart Willis? Yes, he is the great grandson of Sir Walter. So his Ulster connections are there. And he's actually spoke about his great grandfather and him being the Unionist MP and his connections of his family back here in Ulster. So you can see how the tentacles of Locker Lampson and the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division stretched out across it. And all four Ulster men died with it. 17 deaths in all, 7 reported, a number were captured as PROs. That is, and it became today that we know it as the Tank Division and the Armoured Car Divisions. These were the forerunners at the beginning of what we know today as those services. Locker, in 1919, had a reunion dinner of the Royal Naval Armoured Car Division with all his men. His men were so partaken by him, so respectful of him, that they produced a silver-plated little Rolls-Royce armoured car, and they presented it to Locker for their gratitude in being part of his Royal Naval Armoured Car Division. So you can see how the men thought of him as well. Locker died in 1953, and on his death, his family sold off all his Unionist memorabilia, or Lordist memorabilia, which fetched over £1,000. So he must have had a good stock of Lordist or Unionist memorabilia from that period that was able to fetch £1,000. So this, but he's well remembered for a host of different other reasons. Whereas, and probably one of the things that we never recognised or we never got to hear about is the exploits of the men from Ulster and the men from the Shankill Road who went to the Russian front and fought in those hazardous battles. There's only been one ever book written about it, and that was called The Tsar's British Squadron. No other recount of it or written format of it has ever been tabled. So you can see how hard it is. I'm not surprised that nobody's really ever heard of Locker Lampson or really never heard of the involvement of the EVF in the Russian Revolution or the murder of Rasputin and things like that there. So now you all know.